Hey guys, Mike here. Hope all of you are doing well. I wanted to shoot a quick video regarding the Canadian real estate market and my thoughts on sort of what has happened in the past 5 or 10 years, and more importantly, where do I sort of see this the housing market going? So again, for those of you that don't know me, my name is Michael Hernick. I have a Facebook page called The Financial Mechanic. The whole purpose of why I have that page is to sort of provide free financial education for you guys. So if you haven't checked out my video I posted about a month ago, I did a video really looking at my thoughts on the stock market in general. Is there a correction coming in 2020 and so on. So again, if you haven't had a chance to take a peek at that video, I highly recommend you go see that if you're interested. Otherwise, if you're interested in what I'm doing, if you like sort of the content I'm sharing, if you have any thoughts or any comments on what you want me to talk about, I would highly recommend you sort of send me a comment or send me a message. I would love your support if you can click like, share this video with anyone that you feel can get some value from this. So again, just let me know. The last video I shot with the stock market, I did get some positive feedback, and some of you are sort of wanting some more information on how sort of what red flags do I see in the stock market. So I think I'll do that as another video coming soon. So again, if you have any ideas, anything, please share, support the page. I'd really appreciate your feedback. So with all of that, Canadian real estate. So let's look at I always like looking at the last 10, 12 years, because that's a nice reflection of what has sort of happened. Of course, with markets, we always have cycles. So when we go back to 2008, 2009, when we look at what happened in the US more specifically, we basically had a market crash in all financial assets, and real estate being one of them. However, I want to focus on the real estate side. So the main reason why real estate sort of took a huge hit in those years is because of the subprime crisis. So basically what was happening is you had financial institutions, banks in the US basically lending to individuals that had difficulty either paying them back or just simply put weren't sort of qualified to have that mortgage. And what's more interesting I found is in 2008, 2009, in Canada, we weren't really impacted from a real estate side in general. In fact, our market sort of continued to just grow. That has a lot of different reasons why. A couple more notable reasons is in the US, there's less regulations with banking. In Canada, as you guys know, we have CIBC, BMO, TD, RBC, all the big, we got a four or five big banks, and they're highly regulated by the government. In the US, of course, banks are regulated too, but a lot less so. You have a lot more private banks and a lot more lenders that there's just simply put less regulation in the US. Of course, after 2008, 2009, they sort of tightened up their belts a little bit with regulation. So now that in the US, they call it FHA loans. And now in Canada, we have CMHC loans. So anyway, long story short, I'll talk about that when I get to interest rates. But long story short, some regulations sort of came into the US to sort of help the real estate market sort of continue to grow over the last 10, 5, 10 years. And that also had to do with interest rates. So anyway, I talk more about interest rate manipulation and the effect that has on asset prices. So if that's something that interests you, I'd recommend you go into my previous video I posted regarding the stock market. But I will talk about interest rates later on in when it comes to real estate. So in Canada, in 2008, 2009, basically interest rates sort of fell, and we have basically now something called CMHC. So again, if you haven't heard of what this is basically an insurance for the bank. So it's kind of insurance for insurance. So what happens is if you basically put less than 20% down from a general standpoint, you have to get a CMHC mortgage, which basically means you're paying a premium to have this organization insure your mortgage in the event that something were to happen. And the banks love this because now they have less liability and less risk from their standpoint. So of course, they would prefer to lend on mortgages that are CMHC because someone's actually insuring it. And that's sort of how what happened. So over the last 5, 10 years, the real estate in Canada has grown, has grown, has grown. And in 2016, 2017, we sort of saw more of a softening of the marketplace. And I think that's really interesting to note. partially for the growth in Canada in real estate. We had growth in oil and other commodity prices from 2008. That has definitely gone the other way now. But as commodity prices go up, then employment opportunities increase. And when employment opportunities increase, so does real estate, because presumably, whoever is working for these companies is going to buy real estate. So that, coupled with lower interest rates, sort of helped real estate get up and up and up. But in 2016, 2017, we had a bit of a softening of commodity prices, oil prices, and more importantly, the stress test sort of came in around that time too. So for those of you that don't know what the stress test is, again, I'm not a mortgage broker or a financial planner or anything like that. So everything I say is purely my opinion. If you need more consultation on any of this, I highly recommend you reach out to experts. But I sort of describe the more education side and try to simplify it for you guys. But basically, the stress test was, hey, if you can previously qualify for 2%, now you have to qualify for like 4% or whatever it is. So you're basically, it's a stress test from the standpoint that you need to qualify. Hey, can you still make your payments at a higher interest rate? Yes or no? And what that has effectively done is caused a softening of real estate. And if any of you that watch this are in the lending market in any capacity, you know that that has certainly had an impact. Because what happens is, unless you buy a home or other real estate for cash, you're going to need to borrow the money. And who's borrowing that money is the bank. So if the banks aren't able to lend to you because now we've got borrowers that can't qualify at that stress test rate, that has an impact on real estate because now buyers can't qualify for mortgages and cannot buy property, or less so, right? And that's what has happened. So over the last 2, 3 years, that has happened. What's also interesting to note, I'll talk about later on, is how interest rates have sort of fluctuated since then. But anyway, I will touch on that too. When we look at Saskatchewan, you sort of see that the market has the real estate in Saskatchewan has sort of crept up and gone up about 2016, 17, and has really started to fall for the last 2, 3, 4 years. I read an article that inventory is lower than last year in general. So basically, what that means is there's less houses available for sale. So I think that's interesting. With any statistic you read or listen to, you have to take it with a grain of salt because, lower inventory or less houses for sale can be from many different reasons. Someone couldn't sell their house, so they're not relisting it. Or in fact, there's just more demand, so there's less houses available. There's just so many different things that can happen. So again, I highly, scrutinize anything you hear on the media, especially because you can really, there's always underlying assumptions you need to think about. But anyway, at any rate, it looks like the marketplace has sort of, may still soften out a little bit, but things are a little bit more stable. I want to comment on BC and Ontario. So of course, when you look at your Torontos and Vancouvers, that's always an interesting market. I always like looking at that because when you actually see what's happened, Vancouver and Toronto prices have just gone up and up and up, and they have also softened a little bit over the last year or two. But I always hear the argument that, oh, like Vancouver and Toronto are always, they're in a huge bubble and they'll burst, and it very well could be. But what I always sort of play devil's advocate to say is that the fundamental fact of what's happening in BC and Toronto is this, is that especially in BC, people want to live in BC. And especially as baby boomers get older and retire and sort of want to live in a warmer climate and sort of take advantage of the benefits of B that BC has to offer, that will in fact push real estate prices to go up. And that's really what's happening, is people just want to live in these markets. Same thing as Toronto. People want to live downtown Toronto and live that lifestyle. So and what happens is there's more demand for rent, and then of course investors go in and say, oh, there's so much rental demand, so they go and buy condominiums, and it's just a whole cycle, right? So really, what the point I'm getting at here is that people want to live in those markets. And same thing in the US, in New York. When you look at some of the and Los Angeles, like, oh my gosh, real estate is so expensive. But at the end of the day, people want to live there, and it's just at what cost? Can the market sort of be volatile? Oh, 100% it can be. But I think long term, especially in BC and in Ontario, when you look at your sort of Vancouver's and Toronto's long term, I think the demand for wanting to be in those city centers is going to always be there. So long term, likely is going to be that demand will always be there. Now, when it comes to short term, that's sort of the piece I want to talk about, is because I always get this question is, You know, Mike, is it a good time to buy? Is it a good time to sell? What do we do? So now that you sort of shared my comments on BC, Saskatchewan, Ontario, the thing I always say with buying or selling at this point is this is unless you're planning. So for those of you that are looking at buying a place for yourself, this is strictly not for investment purposes. Strictly for yourself, principal primary residence. You're looking for a home, okay? My comment is this: unless you're planning to live in that home for at least 5 years or longer, then it may be wise to wait. And the reason why I say that is for a couple of reasons. The main reason, and this goes in any market in Canada, main reason why I say that is if you buy now, so for example, if you get, you know, new employment in a new city and you're just not sure if that's the right place to be, if you buy a home in that marketplace, and let's say in a year you have to relocate or move your family and yourself out, and now you're sort of forced to sell. You may lose on the sell because we're not really sure what's going to happen over the next 3, 4, 5 years in the marketplace. In fact, I would argue that prices may still soften out a little bit, but long term will be stable and maybe some growth in the latter future. So if you're in a position where you've bought a home now and a year or two or three have passed and now you have to sell, you may lose money on that purchase. And to also take another thing that no one really talks about is the closing costs of actually buying and selling real estate. So when you buy a house, you've got to pay a lawyer, you've got to get an inspection. So ultimately, you're paying really 2.5 to 5% of your purchase price on all these miscellaneous things of what I always call just getting into the property. And then on the selling side, it's the same thing. If you hire a realtor, unless you sell privately, you have to pay your realtor on the selling side. Typically not on the buying side, but on the selling side, yes. So you have closing costs. That coupled in potential volatility in real estate over the next 1, 2, 3 years is not favorable. And that's why I say, unless you're looking to purchase a home and stay in that home and in that location for at least 5 years or longer, then it may be wise to sort of rent in the meantime and just wait. For those of you that know that, you know, Saskatoon, Vancouver, or Edmonton, Calgary, for wherever you live, that this is your place of home. I want to grow my family here. My relatives live here. I have a good job and I want to be here for the long term. Then it is a buyer's market. So again, what I really caution is to really look at your long-term plans as, hey, you know, do we see ourselves living here over the next 5 years? If so, then yes. Go out and the other thing I always encourage people with real estate is throw out offers. The worst thing that people can say is no. I think that we as individuals feel really you know, scared to offend others with an offer or a price that, you know, is more comfortable to us. But at the end of the day, you have to remember that you have a buyer and a seller in every transaction. And if the seller wants to sell, they will listen to you. So they can say no, but that's the worst thing that can happen is no. Yeah, maybe you wasted some time to write up an offer, but the worst thing that can happen is no. So I always sort of tell people, you know, don't be afraid to be, you know, be realistic, of course, but you know, throw some numbers around and see if it sticks. If it sticks, great. If not, then throw another number at the seller or keep looking because there is still a lot of inventory out there. Now, anyhow, so that's with the buying selling. So again, recap, big thing is, you know, if you're looking for 5 years or longer, then it's a good time to buy. If not, then, you know, maybe think twice to see if you want to maybe hold off and get a better idea of where life's journey will take you. Now, I want to talk about interest rates for a little bit because I get a lot of questions about interest rates because interest rates have a huge impact on real estate. So, couple things. I want to talk about what Bank of Canada's overnight lending rate is and the prime rate of the banks and what does all this mean? Because the media talks about this a lot and it's important in my opinion that you are educated and know what these things mean. So first of all, in Canada we have the Bank of Canada that sort of that dictates the overnight lending rate. So when you hear in the media, oh, interest rates have fallen or are going up, that they're talking about the Bank of Canada's overnight lending rate. In the US, it's just the federal overnight interest rate, the US interest rate. Here in Canada, we call it the Bank of Canada rate. Same thing. So in Canada right now, interest rates are 1.75% from the Bank of Canada. However, I just looked this morning. RBC's prime rate is like 3.95%. So it's always confusing. It's like, well, wait a second, Mike, 1.75% Bank of Canada, but then RBC, Scotia's at 3.9%. What's the difference? So the answer is that the bank creates their own prime rate. They make it up. Why? Because they make money on interest. So what happens is So 3.95%, 1.75%. So this overnight lending rate is the rate that the banks sort of lend to each other's overnight lending rate, in the sense that Scotia and these, you know, BMO, CIBC, they lend to each other at 1.75%, and then the bank, then the bank's prime rate itself, 3.95% is what it is now in all the big banks. The spread between 1.75% and 3.95% is the spread they're making, or the margin that they make. So the difference between 1.75 and 3.95, they make that. That's money that they make. But what's even more interesting is it doesn't stop at 3.95%. For many of you that have lines of credits, credit cards, you know that it's another plus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5%. So not only are they making money from the 1.75 to the 3.95, but then they tack on a plus something. And really, at the end of the day, that it's so that banks make money. And that's really what it comes down to. How do they come up with 1.75%? The Bank of Canada determines this. How does the RBC Scotiabank come up with their own prime rate of 3.95%? That's made up. They decide that. So typically what happens is this, is let's say Royal Bank raises their prime rate to like 4.1%. Then the other banks are like, oh, RBC did it, let's just do it too. And they all kind of just follow the leader kind of thing. And that's exactly what happens. So when you see, if Bank of Canada's rate goes down, then typically the banks will lower their own prime rate. That's usually what happens, and vice versa. If the Bank of Canada raises their rates to, let's say, 2%, then RBC Scotiabank's prime rate will definitely be more than 3.95%, because they'll follow suit and create their own sort of prime rate and then charge that. So anyhow, if that makes sense, or you want some more information on that, I'd be happy to share more comments on that. Just send me a message. But anyway, basically, long story short, the banks are making money via interest. And so if anytime you hear on the media that the Bank of Canada's overnight lending rate has fallen, then the bank's prime rate will typically follow suit. And then your interest rate on your mortgages and your credit cards, lines of credits, and other debt will go down. Same thing for corporate debt. Corporations borrow from financial institutions. Same thing. They'll be expected to pay less, because Bank of Canada's rate now is maybe 1.5 or 1.25%. Why do we care even? Okay, this is why we care. Because in 2008 and 2009, interest rates are basically nothing. They're 0%. So Bank of Canada's rate was zero, but then RBC Scotia had their own prime rate of like 1.752%. So again, that spread. So they create their own prime rate, plus they tack on their percentages. But anyway, interest rates were much lower 10 years ago. And now they need them to go up. And I can do an entire video on why the Bank of Canada and the government need the interest rates to go up. But it has basically to do with inflation and the value of money and stuff like that. I don't want to overcomplicate it. But what has happened is the rates have been trending upwards. And a couple of years ago, the Fed has sort of raised the rates and sort of has kept the rates there. And the reason why is because, one, they need the rates to go up. So ultimately, they want rates to continue to rise, but they have to be very careful, because what happened was a couple of years ago, they kept creeping their rates up. And what was happening is they actually started seeing some pushback in the marketplace, and they sort of realized that the marketplace may not be ready for higher interest rates at this time. For, you know, people are less likely to pay back, and there's no economic growth, less employment opportunities. So they want them to go up, but the market's not ready for it. And they have to be very careful, because if Bank of Canada raises interest rates too quickly, they can basically self-inflict a recession. And that's their worst. That's really what they're afraid of. So they want rates to go up, but they have to be very careful. So what has effectively happened over the last year or so is rates haven't really moved, which is interesting, because I hear a lot of times from people, oh goodness, you know, interest rates may go up to 15, 20% like they were 20 years ago. And in my opinion, it's impossible. And I'll tell you why that's impossible. It's possible because it happened, but in this current marketplace, I think it's impossible. And it's very simple to explain. When you look at, you know, 10, 15, not even, sorry, I shouldn't say 10, but 20, 25 years ago, when interest rates were above 10%, let's just call it 15%, 15% interest rate on a mortgage, because that's what it used to be. So everyone talks about the interest rate here, but no one talks about how cheap real estate was then. You could buy a house for under $100,000. Yes, you're paying 15% interest rate on your loan, but you're also getting a much higher interest rate on any investments you have in the bank. So a normal checking savings account will pay a lot more percentage of a return. Now it's like basically nothing. So not only have interest rates were super high 25 years ago, but real estate was super low. So what has effectively happened is this, the scale has moved. Now interest rates have fallen, but what has happened is because interest rates fall, money's cheaper, people are buying, and now you have the same $100,000 house worth $400,000 or $500,000 when interest rates went from 15% to basically nothing and now about 2-3%. So my point is we've basically had the shift from interest rates falling to real estate rising. This is typically what happens. So in order for interest rates to be back up to 15-20% like they used to be, you would need housing to be basically 25-50-75% lower than they are now, even more than that, right? The same $400,000 house would have to be $100,000, $150,000. And then maybe interest rates could support that because now housing is cheaper and more people can get into the marketplace. So the banks see that there's like, right? The economy basically works and it works like that is, you know, as interest rates fall or rise, real estate and other assets sort of reflect that. So it's all connected, you know, employment, interest rates. It's just everything is such a linked cycle that one shift here means this kind of shift here. And that's what's happened is the Fed tried raising interest rates, prices fell, and now they're basically stabilizing. And then the US have already dropped the interest rate. So here's what's really even more interesting. So again, not only do I think it's impossible for interest rates to go back up to even anywhere remotely over 5-6%, the market can't handle it. But what's more interesting is I read an article that suggested that the US is open to the idea of not only lowering interest rates, but the Fed is kind of, hey, if we go negative, that may not be the worst thing. So this whole idea of negative interest rate is just complete silliness. Japan has negative 0.5% interest rate. What does that even mean? How can an interest rate be negative? Am I getting paid to have a debt? Am I getting charged up money in the bank? That's exactly what happened. So I can do a whole video on negative interest rates. But the point I'm getting at is the government uses interest rates to manipulate asset prices. And that's exactly what's happening is because the economy is sort of limping in Canada specifically, they're going to try and decrease interest rates as much as they can to keep sort of real estate stocks afloat. But the problem is we're at 1.75%. So there's only so much room that they can sort of decrease that to get it back up to back down. You know, you can go to zero, but unless you go below zero, then you're going negative. So anyway, long story short, it's very interesting. The takeaway is this: when it comes to real estate, if you're in a position that you're able to buy a home and you want to buy a home, I would highly, you know, encourage you to think about your long-term plans. If you're planning to be there for longer than 5 years, yes, I think it's a good time to buy. Can the market still soften out? Absolutely. But if you're in it for the long term, you don't really care because you know you're gonna need a roof over your head anyway. If you're not in that position, I would recommend maybe just holding off and renting in the meantime. Just kind of wait for the markets to kind of do their own thing. And then once you have a better idea of if, hey, you know, I got this new job in Vancouver or Edmonton, and yes, I want to stay here, I like it here, then maybe it's a good idea to buy. But I always sort of caution this situation, like I said earlier, where you're not sure, you buy a home and then you're forced to sell and then you may lose money. The second thing is interest rates. Do I think interest rates will go up? They may a little bit, but long-term, the economics aren't there. It's just simply put, I think you're gonna see interest rates be fairly stable and flat over the next 5-10 years. And we'll kind of see what happens. But you know, the idea of interest rates going anywhere above 5-7%, I think is absolutely silliness. And you know, and I don't think it's really possible unless we have real estate really crash and go down low enough for that to happen. There's really no indicators that that may happen. But again, everything is possible, but that's just sort of my thoughts on it. So anyway, long story short, that's my viewpoint on Canadian real estate, interest rates, thrown a lot at you guys. If you found this interesting and you want to share this with your friends and family, highly recommended, would love the feedback, any comments, anything. You know, again, my page is The Financial Mechanic. It's there for free education to you guys in terms of, you know, this big picture finance stuff. So if you like what I'm doing, so, you know, I appreciate your support. If you disagree with me and you want to challenge me on anything, you know, throw it at me. I would love to have that discussion. Anything that, you know, say, hey, Mike, I kind of disagree with you here. Tell me. I would love to hear from you. So again, if you enjoyed it, please, you know, share the page, click like. Otherwise, I'm hoping to do a video like this every couple of weeks or every month, just sort of when I think of a good topic to talk about. Again, if there's something that you want me to talk about, I think I will do a video on sort of what kind of factors are in place now to suggest that a stock market correction could come. I think I've got some feedback from you guys that you know, I kind of mentioned the problem, but some of you are like, well, okay, Mike, I get that there could be a problem, but what factors and what red flags are there? And I think I'll do a video on that. Anyhow, again, thanks for watching. Really appreciate it. Let me know what you thought. Otherwise, we'll see you guys next time.